Your attention, please. And now, on with the show.
Live from Paradise Studios in New York, Strong Island Television presents Under the Radar, starring Randy Unger.
Brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a two to match your attitude.
Tonight, we're going to be interviewing actress, comedian, and model Eugenia Kuznina. Randy will also be reviewing the new films Honey Boy and Dr. Sleep with special guest critics CJ Oakland and Ivy Loftberg. And now, here's your host, Randy Unger.
Hey guys, I'm Randy Unger, and this is another edition of Unger the Radar, where we talk all things film. And right now, through Skype, I have actress, comedian, and model Eugenia Kuznina. Hey, Eugenia, how's it going?
Hi, really good. Really good to be here with you live.
Yeah, welcome, welcome. So how's your day going?
Oh, I can see you now. I love
yes.
that.
Okay. Yes. The wonder of technology.
Yes, it's true.
So how's everything going?
It's great, you know, just have a little bit of time off. I was promoting a horror film last night at the LA Live Film Festival downtown, and kind of keep busy, you know, with kids and everything.
Yeah, I know. You're very, very busy. Actress, comedian, model. What's it like being a triple threat?
You know, and Russian, too.
Russian-American. Quadruple threat.
It's fun, you know. I think I'm a dreamer, so I think it's always interesting to stay creative and busy, and you know, there's so many things that interest me in life, so I'm really lucky to be able to do them.
Okay. Is there one job that you prefer over the other, actress or model, comedian, or are they kind of all equal to you?
You know, it really depends on the team that I'm working with. For me, it's really important if you do a movie, it's with a specific director or writer. You know, there are a lot of people I admire and really happy to work with them. But also, I think there's nothing like live shows. Doing stand-up comedy is just one of a kind thing because you have live audiences and, you know, there's no editing, so you better be funny in the moment.
That's cool. Yeah, I don't know if I could do stand-up comedy. That seems very challenging. How do you get into that mindset?
Never say never. I don't know. I was never a person who would be like a clown of the class. I actually was very shy, so it would be like the last thing that I would think I would do in the future. But when I started acting, I was looking kind of to grow more, you know, and I wanted to do theater. And the roles are pretty limited because I have a specific accent. So I was doing a film called Fading Gigolo with Woody Allen in New York. And I know that he was doing stand-up at some time, and I learned a lot about it. And I thought, why not to try to do, you know, stand-up because it's live and it's kind of a theater, but actually I didn't know what I was getting into.
Do you experience a lot of heckling?
No, I wish I had more heckling because more fun. Like that would be, you know, more interesting, I would think. You know, I actually don't mind hecklers, but for some reason, I don't have enough hecklers. So okay. If you guys are watching this, please come and throw tomatoes and.
Nice. Now, did you start off as a model? Was that your first career?
Yeah, I started off as a model actually really young, like when I was born, literally. I was not aware of that, but they took me to photograph for, you know, some local newspaper, and that's how it got started. And then I did some comedy and a little bit of acting as a child, and then I got into modeling just because it was much better for me to support my family that way, and I could travel, you know, I could go to Paris, and that's what was my focus, yeah.
Okay. So what are some of your highlights for people who don't know your filmography? What are some of the films or TV shows you've done?
There's so many. I mean, I can talk about the things that are coming out.
Yeah, sure.
One is Guy Ritchie's film, which I'm really excited to have a cameo. It's called The Gentleman with Matthew McConaughey.
Cool.
There's a few really amazing actors in it. You can check it out. And I'm really happy to go to Russia to promote it next year. Very exciting. Haven't been there for maybe 10 years. Okay. So it will be very special. And it's an interesting film. You know, it's a gangster kind of action, you know, okay. Really good script, really fantastic to work with Guy. And then I just finished working on Spy series. It's a TV series we shot in Prague, but it's based in Berlin in like 1961 when the wall was built. And I worked with Dominic Cooper, among other amazing, talented actors. And it was super fun to shoot. Other than that, you guys can check me like a New Girl or Castle or Lady Dynamite on TV, Bad Moms. I mean, there's so many projects that, you know, I've been lucky to work on.
Yeah, that's a full plate right there.
Yeah.
How do you go about choosing your roles?
You know, I feel like the roles kind of choose you in some way. Yeah. And also it's something that's really challenging. I mean, you know, there's still like limited ways I think Russians can be portrayed, but I'm really happy that I did a film where I didn't have to play a spy or like a Russian stereotype. I recently did a film with Eric Roberts and I had to play a wife and a mother. So that was something that, you know, was really kind of breakthrough, I think, for me personally as, you know, as an actor.
Right.
I choose roles that are challenging and that are interesting, but also it depends on the script right now, you know, and amazing directors that I really, you know, aspire to work with, because it's not only about me, obviously, you know, it's about a team of people who put together the story. So yeah. It's important to work with people you really respect and love.
That's true. So you're a mother. Do you like acting in roles that are mothers, or do you prefer to go a little bit beyond what you are in reality?
Well, when I started acting, actually, I was really discouraged by everybody in the business just because, you know, it's such a narrow way that with my accent as a Russian, like you would be portrayed. And I feel like I'm so much more, you know, I could be not only like a spy or a gold digger or whatever, you know, it's fun to play those roles, they're comedy roles, but I wanted to do more. So, you know, it's really interesting for me to play a full person who has complex life, and I feel like, you know, it's reflected in my real life, so that's why I want to choose more complex roles.
Right. What's your dream role?
A witch.
Okay, cool. Like an evil witch or like a nice witch?
Oh, like a wild witch. I don't know.
Okay.
I'm really interested about, you know, kind of natural empowerment at this point in my life because I feel, you know, I've went through so much and, you know, there's so many things that I want to say from that perspective.
Okay. So what? And you do it all. You're always in front of the camera. You're in front of an audience. In your mind, what makes a good performer?
I think transparency, honesty, vulnerability. It's not so much about putting the face. I feel like in modeling, you always put on the face. You know, there's like a facade. There's something that you're selling a product, but when you're acting, people actually resonate with emotions, and if you're honest and truthful in that, I think that's what resonates with people.
Okay.
And I think it takes time to actually be so open.
Yeah. Now, what do you hope audiences take away from your film and TV projects, from your performances?
You know, I hope they can see themselves as, you know, the strong, amazing characters too, because I think when we watch a movie, we always identify with some characters, you know, and their storyline. So I hope that my story, you know, coming from a completely different background and, you know, being like a strong, interesting female, which is not like positive or negative, evil or not, it's more complex. I hope that people identify with that.
Okay. Who are some favorite co-stars of yours over the years?
Favorite co-stars? Well, I love Zac Efron. I think he's a very giving actor. You know, I did a few films where I was just starting out, and, you know, it's always like very hard to be new and sad because there are certain dynamics that you step in, but he's so supportive and always there for, you know, reversal, always giving. So it's really inspiring, you know, to see somebody who really cares about the project and other actors on set. Bill Murray is hilarious, you know, Bruce Willis, loves Zoe Deschanel. She's a fantastic singer, had a privilege to spend some time in Morocco with her, and, you know, her singing is like another level of challenge. There's so many, it's just really hard to point. I mean, John Turturro is amazing. He was directing and acting at the same time, and that really is inspiring. Gillian Green-Remy, who directed me in my first film, because she's like a female director, and that's very empowering and interesting. So it's just hard to point one person.
You know, I actually interviewed Gillian, I think it was last year, for Fanboy.
She's one of the first people who really encouraged me, because I started acting after I had kids, and she has 5 kids, so I'm like, if you can do something, I can do it.
Nice. And are there any, would you consider Gillian a mentor?
I would, yeah, definitely. You know, it's somebody who kind of manages to have a family and also, you know, follow your dream, and is a really hard worker and is supportive of, you know, other women. And yeah, for sure.
Cool. I would say that. And now, final question. Do you have any advice for aspiring actresses, comedians out there, or models even? What words of wisdom?
You know, I think it's all about work. It's not about like the glitter and glamour of things, because when I transitioned to acting, I actually didn't know. A lot of models, they think, well, you know, I accomplished a certain, you know, level in modeling, so I can just go on the set. So that doesn't work that way, because I think to be a good actor, it takes a completely different skill. So I think it's really important to work and, you know, train on yourself, or at least have mentors, or always grow as a person, and just focus on work rather than like red carpets and things like that. It's important to promote your films. I think it's important to support filmmakers, but I think the main thing is be grounded and have something outside this business to, you know, to grow as a person.
Nice. So again, for the viewers, what are you working on? What's coming out, and how can they see it?
Spy City, it should be coming out. I'm not sure which channel, but if you Google it, I think they sold it. It's a limited series, TV series. Okay. And then Guy Ritchie's film, it's coming out next year. It's called The Gentleman. Have a few horror films that will be coming out, and hopefully we'll see you in Cannes, guys, too.
Sweet. Well, Eugenia, I want to thank you so much for your time today. This was great.
Thank you.
Yeah, and if you're ever in Long Island, we'd love to have you stop by the studio.
I would love to. I shot a film there, so I've been there for months.
Oh, cool. Where in Long Island?
I don't know exactly, to be honest, because, you know, we had like 12-hour days.
Okay.
12-hour. Yeah, it was like a blur, but it was beautiful.
All right, cool. Well, we'd love to have you come back.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. All right, thanks so much.
Thank you. Have a beautiful day.
You too.
Bye.
All right, guys, so we're going to take a short commercial break, but we'll be back with our film review segment right after this.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a 2 to match your attitude. Patent pending interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry. For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
Hey guys, Randy Unger, Under the Radar, and with me are two very special film critics today. We've got Ivy Lofberg. Hello.
Hi.
Been a while since you've been here.
Oh, it's so great to be back.
Yeah,
thank
for
you.
Sure. Definitely. And Mr. CJ Oakland. Hello.
Hello.
a veteran of the show.
Yeah. You really can't get rid of me.
No, but I don't want to. I don't want to. So guys, Yeah. How are you, by the way?
I'm super good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Things are good with film query?
Film inquiry.
Inquiry?
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, and just been seeing some amazing films. Like, I saw The Joker, and I was ready not to like it, and then it was, like, my favorite movie of the year.
I think it's on my top five for the year, for sure. CJ, how are you?
Doing good.
Yeah, so you, what, about a month ago?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
It's been, like, It's been a while since I've been on the show, honestly.
Yeah, it's been a little crazy, yeah. But I saw you at the Halloween party.
Yeah, that was a good time.
Scares for Cares, guys, hashtag that.
Oh, yeah, that was a great party. Check it out for next year.
Yeah, really good party. So what have you seen lately, but other than the movies we're going to talk about today?
other than the movies we just saw, now you caught me off guard.
I'm sorry. I tend to do that.
I came in ready to talk about these movies. I like push everything else out.
Well, you're
out.
Not going to review these. You're just going to mention them. But did you see Joker? No.
I did. I honestly wasn't as big of a fan of it.
Yeah.
Because it's like, I kind of can't divorce Todd Phillips from Joker, because it's like, I used to really like his comedy, but like, the more like I go back to it, it's like when I see his old movies, I realize a lot of his humor, I describe it like punching down. Like, it's about more making fun of minorities and kind of groups like that. Like, there's a lot of homophobic slurs in his movies that's kind of done of like friends of friends, and like, I kind of don't really enjoy that kind of comedy anymore.
I was surprised that he directed this.
Like, I kind of felt more like I got a lot of his frustration with how movies are kind of done in this movie, and it really kind of rubbed me the wrong way. Like, when Todd Phillips made his cameo telling a joke, it was the joke I hated the most in the movie.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It was in the movie? What joke?
When they're listening in the comedy club, it's just a focus on Arthur as another comedian's talking.
Yeah.
And as he's telling a joke, it's like, it starts out as an okay joke where it's about, like, oh, women look at relationships like buying a car with like a plan and got figured out, and guys are like, I'll take any spot I can get. And I'm with the joke until he says like, oh, a disabled spot, I hope no one sees me parking there. And I'm like, that's really kind of a messed up joke.
Oh my God.
And that I realized like later, like, that's Todd Phillips' voice. That's the joke he made. And I'm like, that kind of explains a lot
too?
Of it. Yeah.
Did he wrote it?
I think he wrote some of it, but I'm not sure.
What did you think of Joker?
Well, now I feel I'd see on you. But I agree. I definitely
like a lot of the movie's good. Like, Joaquin Phoenix is amazing.
Oh, he'll get an Oscar nomination.
Yeah. I'll say aside from Joaquin Phoenix and a lot of like the cinematography and stuff, like, I don't think Todd Phillips put a lot into the movie that I enjoyed as much. Mm-hmm. But it's like, for Joaquin Phoenix alone, like, it's worth seeing.
Yeah. Yeah, I think
I just feel
that's
like they don't do as much of the character as they could, but like, he does a great job.
Terrific performance. Yeah. But guys, let's switch gears a bit.
Yeah,
so we've got two, one I think is a great movie and one of the best of the year. The other, not so much. I was a little disappointed by that one. But the first one that I love, Honey Boy, is a dramedy. No, it's more of a drama. Shia LaBeouf, he wrote it in rehab as part of his therapy. And basically, there he is playing basically his own father in this film about a young kid actor. His father is abusive mentally, physically, and he's trying to, you know, he's just trying to exist and survive his father's reign. And I thought Shia LaBeouf knocked it out of the park here. This was just fantastic all around. The writing is sharp, it's deep, it's thought-provoking. And the performances, even by the young kid, are really good, too.
Oh, yeah, that kid was amazing. Like, he did such a good job playing this character.
Yeah. Noah Jupe. I don't know. Ivy, what did you think of Honey Boy?
Also loved it.
Yeah.
I thought what was amazing about it, too, is like, it's like Shia LaBeouf he's done a lot of bad things, you know, and has been caught on camera doing a lot of things that have caused people harm and was obviously spiraling. And I really love that this director, Amal, she saw something in him and wanted to go on the journey with him and bring out what was behind that and explore that on screen and kind of do it. It felt like a very generous film, like exploring the things that he was going through in a way that the audience could get a picture into something that maybe they never were exposed to before.
Yeah, and this is the first time, this is our feature-length debut, Alma Harrell as director. So that synergy, that working relationship that she has with Shia, phenomenal. So
yeah, like I love the direction of this movie, like how they film everything from like how the scenes are done, where like the first opening shot of like the action scene and then showing him as a kid where like he gets a pie in the face and it's still done as like a technical stunt, and just showing all these things of like how his life has always kind of involved these films, and then seeing the father behind it.
Right.
And I think Shia LaBeouf's amazing for the fact that he's playing his abusive father. Like, he's not trying to demonize him. He's not, like, trying to destroy his father and take out his anger. He's literally trying to understand his father. Like, knowing that he's a bad person and has done horrible things to him and others, but just trying to be, like, understand where he was coming from, what went wrong in his life, what put him there. And that's got to be, like, a really difficult thing, but, like, a powerful thing for an actor.
I mean, is the father... The father is not, like... He is selfish, but he's not evil. He's just
not
a little misguided.
He's just a person who's bitter with life and like is mostly taking it out on the son, even if like he doesn't realize
like
how
he
bad
slaps him around a little. He curses at him.
I love too to like to show like this glamour, supposedly like glamorous life of like a child film star who's doing really well, and then he goes home to like the seedy motel, you know, with a lot of stuff going on in his personal life that's, you know, very, like, not much money and a lot of really difficult things going on. And I think it's really great to show, like, to take the glamour off of, like, being a child star.
And it really, it feels real. Like, it just feels so genuine. And, yeah, Shia, basically Noah Jupe, the young boy, that's Shia LaBeouf. As you know, that's
back in like the Even Stevens days, Disney movies,
or even earlier than that, around that time. Yeah. So it's brilliant.
It was incredible too to see just his commitment to that. Like he knew that he was playing him as a child, and to have that level of maturity.
Yeah.
And like he's going to be incredible. Like I want to see what he's
going to
do.
Yeah, no, I definitely want to see what else he's going to do, because that's a great child actor to like bring that to the role.
And even Lucas Hedges, who plays the older version of that character as the child, the young actor who's troubled. I've never really liked Lucas Hedges. You know, I think he was in Manchester by the Sea and other things. I've never really been impressed by his acting ability, but this actually kind of changed my mind.
Yeah, but I felt like it was a new side of him.
Yeah.
Like, he seemed like, I think he's an incredible actor, and I think he's been good at playing, like, the quieter characters, and to see that he had that character in him, you know, that was so ferocious.
Just... That rage. Because of his father, his repressed childhood trauma. So, I mean, guys, this is definitely on my top, I think top five. Do you see awards coming at this film?
I'm hoping it does get awards because it's such like a well-done film.
Yeah.
Like even just for like being a personal story and what it wants to tell, it's so technically well done and the acting's amazing that I think it's definitely worth like looking at everything that the people have done. And like, I definitely hope it wins some awards.
Yeah.
I hope so too. And I really like that Shia is an incredible actor who I feel like has gone through such incredibly difficult times. And it's like I really love that someone gave him the opportunity to just do what he does best and kind of do it in a way that she seemed like she was not afraid of him, and she just wanted to give him a space to explore this character too, and I love that.
I think that's true art right there, taking risks, know, so that's very cool. I've mentioned this movie many times. It's Shia LaBeouf's, right before this he did The Peanut Butter Falcon.
I haven't seen that.
Oh my God.
I still want to see that.
CJ, have you seen it?
I still have to see it.
Still haven't seen it?
Yeah, I didn't get a chance to see it in theaters.
Fantastic film. That's more of a dramedy. And basically, he plays this gruff fisherman who comes in contact with this escaped Down syndrome kid. Actually, he's about 20. He escapes from a nursing home. He meets up with Shia, and they basically go on this like journey together. And they basically bond. And you've got Dakota Johnson's in there. Who am I thinking? The Thomas Hayden Church has a very awesome role in that. I won't give anything away, but The Peanut Butter Falcon, guys. I think that's number one for me on my list. And Honey Boy is like not far away from that.
Nice.
So, this movie, I can't get over this movie.
It's really well done. Like, I just saw it and I'm like still riding the high of it. Like, just there's so much to love of how the movie's done, like of all the different ways of like the child actor, Shia LaBeouf and his performance, been just seeing like how everything was told was just so well done.
True.
It's so true. I love how they went back and forth too, yeah, between him in rehab and him in child, and kind of the through line of this chicken that just follows him around in his life, and like what that represents for
that Shia LaBeouf's Rosebud is just a chicken walking
around. Yeah, exactly.
Nice. But yeah, no, the back and forth of time periods, it's like it's very jarring. So it's kind of like symbolic of his own mental state, like he's all over the place.
Oh, I agree. I really love how they did the beginning where you see him being blown back, and then you see him, and then that's the next the scene. He's like, "I'm fine. There's nothing wrong with me." And then I have no trauma. And then the next that you see, it's a little kid. He's been being, you know, blown back.
That scene was pretty cool because I think it was a little bit of a nod to his days on Transformers, because he did all these like very
big stunts.
Yeah,
that was like the big
stunts.
Budget one. I think that was Transformers period, and then like him is still as a child star, like doing stuff like that.
Yeah, really cool. Really cool. Yeah. So guys,
I love Shia LaBeouf. Like, I've loved a lot of his movies. Like, I'm not as big a fan of the Transformers movies, but I still love Shia LaBeouf in them.
He was like, totally wasted in those movies.
I know. Like, there's not much he can do in a Transformers movie. Like, but like, there's so many roles he's done that he's done such a great job in. And, like, I love him as like a creative person outside of that too, where he just does the weirdest things.
Yeah.
But I always like respect him just like trying to do different things and taking risks and just being a weird actor with it, because what else is he going to do with his life?
He is like, unpredictable. He's awesome.
Yeah. I'm glad he's doing better. Yeah.
Me too. And it's funny to look. I was reading some articles about it, and it's funny to see like he was called like a. At the time, it shows kind of how misunderstood he was, because he was called like the next Tom Hanks. You know, like he's not. He was like by different magazines,
maybe.
And I feel like he was very misunderstood because he's not. You know, he's this wild card who has a lot to offer.
He's his own and his own thing. He really, Did you guys see Eagle Eye?
No.
I did. Yeah.
It was from like 2007.
Yeah, it was something like that, like 2006, 2007.
I think he plays just like this normal guy who gets thrust into this espionage type situation.
Yeah, where it's like the NSA, like kind of going into there and like the satellite spying on people.
It wasn't bad. I think it was from the same director as Disturbia, which was one of his first. I think that was right before Transformers.
Yeah, Disturbia was like right before Transformers came out.
Yeah, and that was like basically a remake of Rear Window.
Yeah,
not very good, but still decent. When,
I mean, it was good enough to get sued over being a remake of Rear Window. So, that's good enough.
It was all right. So guys, final thoughts on Honey Boy? See it, skip it, or
absolutely see it?
Yeah, see it.
I say see it as well. See it. I just saw it on the other night, and I was about to go with you today to go see it.
I know.
I want to see it again. And it's weird too, because there's only like two main sets. There's the motel room, and then there's kind of like everything else. But the motel room is like the main base.
Yeah, they do so much stuff at that location. They manage to sell it all.
Like with those limited locations, I think they could even turn this into a stage play, actually.
That might be possible.
Shia, think about it. Adapt your own material for stage. All right, guys.
Well, you don't want to see Transformers the musical?
Oh God! The top hat and the cane.
I just saw the fear in your eyes.
That fear is real, my friend.
I just found out they're doing like Percy Jackson and the Lightning Thief as a musical on Broadway, and I'm like, how are they going to make that work?
Oh, yeah.
They gotta stop.
Wait, Percy, that's the, is that like a Harry Potter type franchise?
It's a similar one. It's like a fantasy one. I've heard great things about it, actually.
Yeah, I don't know. No interest. But Honey Boy, see it. It's amazing. Can't talk about it enough. Can't praise it enough. And awesome movie. All right, guys, so we're gonna take another commercial break, but we'll be back with our second film review, Dr. Sleep, right after this.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a 2 to match your attitude. Patent pending interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry. For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
We'll be right back.
guys, we're back. Unger the Radar. I'm your host, Randy Unger. And we are halfway through the film review segment. And this is much different than Honey Boy, unfortunately. This is Stephen King's sequel to The Shining. And it is called Dr. Sleep. And basically, it follows not so young anymore. Danny Torrance, played by Ewan McGregor, who basically, he's an alcoholic. He's trying to run away from his past, from his present. And he basically ends up in this small town. I think it's in New Hampshire, right?
Yeah.
And basically, a strange cult of people with Shining-like abilities are basically trying to, they're basically clashing with Danny Torrance. And you know what? The Shining, it's a classic. It's a horror icon. And, you know, I don't know. This movie just seemed a little bit unnecessary. I liked it, but I didn't love it, and I was kind of, like, disappointed, is all I'm saying.
I actually really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Like, it's definitely, like, it's different from The Shining. Like, The Shining was its own thing, and for this one, it's, like, I like the way they allude to The Shining, but it's definitely a different pace. It's a different style of, like, horror and thriller, but it shows, like, the trauma of, like, what happened at the Overlook Hotel, how it affects Danny Torrance, how he still sees the ghosts, and, like, how it impacts him, and how he decides to, like, go into the third act there.
Yeah.
Like, I really enjoyed how they did that, because it could be a real double-edged sword going to what's a classic movie. Like, it could have made it look really bad in comparison, but I think they managed to do it in a really well way, where the stuff they did original was good, and how they called back to it, I think, was pretty well handled.
I think, as a sequel to The Shining, it kind of, it doesn't fail as much, but I think, as a horror movie on its own, if it's its own entity, if it's not connected to The Shining, it would have been a lot better. But I don't know. What did you think?
I felt like what I liked about it is that it the original Shining is, I think, a classic, and Kubrick is such a, I mean, incomparable. Yeah. And so I think it's definitely brave to take on, like, a Kubrick film as a sequel. And what I did like about it is I found, for me, like, The Shining to be, it was scary, but it was a little more like psychological horror, and it was easy to kind of to separate like, it wasn't a supernatural movie to me.
Right.
And I felt like, in terms of just pure horror.
You're talking about the original or this one?
I'm talking about the new one.
Okay.
I found, like, there was a lot of supernatural elements in it, which I felt like if you're going to do a Stephen King novel, I think the only problem I had with The Shining was that if you're going to adapt a Stephen King novel and kind of leave out the sense of, like, real supernatural stuff going on.
Okay.
I felt like this film really brought that back as far as the Stephen King adaptation.
I've read, like, the original novel, The Shining, like, is a very different kind of one from the movie. Like, they have kind of the same events, but they take out so much, like, the supernatural stuff going on, and, like, what Danny Torrance was able to see with, like, the psychic visions, and, like, how Jack Torrance was literally, like, he was meant to be a good man who was possessed and, like, turned evil, whereas The Shining movie, Kubrick, like, chooses Jack Nicholson and, like, makes him seem like he's ready to become a serial killer at any moment. And this is, like, just what pushes him over the edge. So there's a few differences there.
I think Jack Nicholson's character was psychotic in the beginning of the movie. Like, you could see it's late.
No, like, in the movie,
it's ruined. See his eyes.
In the movie, he's meant to be crazy.
Right, right.
Whereas, like, in the book, he's, like, a regular, like, kind of normal, nice guy, and then he's kind of driven crazy.
Now, I didn't read the book. In the book, he gets possessed by a Shining-like entity.
It's more that he's a nice person who the ghosts then go to him, and it starts, like, affecting his soul and turns him, like, completely insane.
Right. Well, that's sort of what happened in the first one.
Yeah.
With
a little
bit,
but it's
sort
like
the
they don't show it as much. It feels more like it's just he was already evil and the hotel just happened to get him.
And he's just having hallucinations of the
bartender. Yeah, I haven't read the Dr. Sleep book they made, but I think, like, definitely it's a difference of how they're calling back to more of, like, how Stephen King the novel was with The Shining. And they're still using a lot of the imageries and, like, the score from the movie The Shining.
Right, right.
So it's kind of an interesting disconnect there, how they're, like, making it a sequel, but it's not entirely a sequel.
Yeah, I agree.
I really like how they find a way for Danny's gift to, he finds peace with it, where he ends up, how he becomes Dr. Sleep, I won't give that away. But I really love that element of it, that it kind of, he's on a journey where he finds a community that he feels really safe in, and he finds a way to use his gift that's very soothing to him. And then it's like 8 years later, you know, something, it comes up that he can't ignore.
I like the relationship between him and Abra?
Abra.
That was good. That was well done.
I really liked the child actor. She did a great job with it. And, like, I really like how they played her character and how they used her. Because there's a lot of times where they try, where I was afraid they were going to make this, like, a young adult kind of movie. Because that's kind of what they did to The Dark Tower, which is one of my favorite Stephen King series. And then when they did the movie, like, Idris Elba's The Gunslinger was amazing. Like, he was so spot on. But they made the movie not about him, but about, like, the teenage sidekick as the main character. But then the movie kind of never really did anything with him, because in the books, he doesn't do as much. He's the sidekick. So it's like, I really hated how they ended up kind of wasting that opportunity in the movie. But this one, they did a really good job with, like, using her abilities, but keeping it R-rated. Like, the action was good. The tension was really well done.
And the return to the Overlook Hotel was pretty great.
That was pretty great. I actually won't spoil anything again, but I really like how it was like he had, in order for him to find, he had to return to that place. I think the only thing I found, like, a little bit cheesy, because Shelley Duvall is such an iconic character, I think I felt a little, like, when, like, a woman was, like, trying to be, that was a little cringe.
Trying to do the voice.
That was odd.
It's hard, like, when you have to do flashbacks, and it's like, you have to try and play someone where, like, she had a very specific quality to her voice. And, like, how she had, like, this really breathless quality.
I thought she sounded like her perfectly.
She sounded like her pretty well done. It's like, they kind of look like him, but not quite, so it was a little jarring. But I think it was well done.
Is it a spoiler to say that someone else shows up?
Yeah, a little.
Is that a spoiler? Damn it, okay.
I know, it's good. All right.
I was expecting it anyway.
Were you? I didn't expect that. That was cool. But I'm surprised they didn't knock down the Overlook Hotel like 40 years ago or 35 years ago after the murders.
I was wondering, and also, like, did they return? Like, I was so fascinated by how they filmed that.
It looked so, like, it was such a great recreation.
It was incredible.
So I was impressed by that.
I also really like this element of, like, I felt like in some ways this movie was, like, really, really scary, like, to see when the group, like, would attack a child.
Oh, God, that was terrifying. That's the opening
scene.
That was really well done.
Of, like, you want to have someone stop it, but it's like, that's a really good element to the horror there of, like, why these people are the monsters, and they definitely prove it.
Yeah, they really do, and I like, it's so different from the original Shining, where that, like, it's just a family, and you're building on the tension of this family kind of also being locked away, you know, and being so isolated, and the story is just so radically different, too, and them just exploring some completely different ideas than just a family.
And the whole cult storyline, it was interesting, actually, and I think Rebecca Ferguson did a good job as the leader
of
that cult.
Yeah, the villain, she did a great
job. She was a good villain, I'd say. So
she was very, like, charismatic. It felt like I think she like had that really good line of, like, I always really liked when she came on screen, but also when, you know, she meets her end, it was satisfying.
Yeah, she's likable and unlikable at the same time.
It's just hard to do.
She pulled it off nicely. So see it, skip it, Ivy?
I think see it, but I think if you're, like, I think see it knowing it's not going to, it's not, like, Shining 2.
Like, if you're a fan of Stephen King stuff, definitely go see it. If you don't like Stephen King, but you love The Shining with Kubrick's take on it, then you might not like
it as much. See, that's how I went in. That's how I went in, and I was,
like,
disappointed.
I'm a Stephen King fan, so I'm, like, I was ready for all of the stuff, the weird stuff that was going on. I'm like, oh, yeah, I've seen him do this several times in his novel. So I'm, like, I'm right on board with it.
And you were on for It, right?
A few months ago. This one more than It, too, because I feel like It, too, just did a lot of jump scares. Like, the first one did a good job with it. The second one, I feel like they lost a lot of their steam. With Dr. Sleep, I love how they present, like, a lot of the psychic visions and, like, them, like, seeing people from other places, and, like, they have such great special effects of like how the characters are interacting in their minds, which a lot of movies do a bad job with that. Like every X-Men movie where it's like Charles Xavier staring at something and someone staring back at him. And it's like, there's a lot of movies where that's what the psychics do, but like shows like Legion or this one, Dr. Sleep, like I love how they presented the battles happening in their mind.
Cool, cool. I love well that done. Too. Yeah. And yeah. I love the scene too where she goes into... She was a very, like, Rebecca Ferguson, she was a very lush character. Like, when they went into her mind, it was a cathedral. Yeah. It was, like, this beautiful place that you almost wanted to spend time in. But she's also this very, like, I like, too, she's not an evil character. She's just a character, like, that's her... Their way
she's
of
she's just willing to do anything to survive. Know. Yeah,
right. Even if it means kidnapping kids.
Yeah, which is
if that's
evil.
Part of her you know her way of thinking, her way of behaving. Then so be
and
it.
I always really like supernatural films like that too, where it kind of shows like she is an evil character.
Yeah,
and then she's also like. She's just this creature that's existing that humans there so happen to be her form of survival, which is something they have to protect yourselves against. So I like that complexity.
And you know, I'm curious, guys. I just thought it's you know the show Castle Rock.
Yeah, I saw the first season.
That takes pieces from all Stephen King worlds.
It's like inspired by it, and they kind of do nods to it.
Do they do anything with The Shining in that? Do you know?
They do one thing where there's a character who's supposed to be like the niece of Jack Torrance. So she kind of calls herself Jackie Torrance because she wants to piss off her parents. And I'm like, that's a little on the nose.
Here's Jackie. Right?
Yeah, like, yeah. I don't know. But, like, I like how Dr. Sleep handled it. Like, they did a lot of, like, nice nods to it and, like, some of his other works.
And you know what? Mike Flanagan, the filmmaker, I just want to make a shout out. Good friend Thomas Puglisi, he's a fellow critic. He's been on a few times. He has been quoted, well, I'm quoting him now. He's saying that Mike Flanagan is the future, he's the tomorrow of horror. And I kind of see that. I would definitely see another Flanagan horror film. I mean, he definitely showed, like, a good ability of behind the camera here.
Yeah, like, I like a lot of his stuff. Also, you have his Wikipedia page up, not meaning to spoil it, but, like, seeing some of the movies he's directed, I'm like, oh, yeah, I like that one, I like that one. It's like, I like how I was handling it.
Oculus, Absentia, Hush, Before I Wake, Ouija, Origin of Evil, Gerald's Game, and Doctor Sleep. So, okay.
The first Ouija movie was really bad, and then Ouija Origin of Evil was actually really good.
Okay.
Like, that threw me off. Like,
I could see that being really, really creepy, yes.
Yeah, like, for how they handled it from the time period, I'm like, they did a really good job with it. Like, there's a lot of times where the creepy girl with, like, kind of a CGI face they go to when she's doing horror things, like, where that goes really bad, but honestly, how they did it in that movie, like, really stuck with me. You're like, that's actually terrifying. Like, that would scare the shit out of me if it came at me at the middle of the night.
Yeah.
I'll give it to him. He's a well-done horror director.
Yeah, I would definitely check out all those movies. It's really good. So, CJ, see it, skip it?
I say see it, honestly. Yeah. Like, if you're a fan of supernatural horror, it's a well-done one.
Yeah.
It's definitely worth checking out, and it's got some nice nods to The Shining. But if you want, like, an exact... like sequel to The Shining, like don't expect that. Like this isn't a sequel for the hotel. This is more a sequel for the psychic powers.
Right.
And like it features the hotel in there as well.
All right, guys. And you know what? I just want to go to a sort of a tangent. What are your feelings real quick about the late great Stanley Kubrick, Ivy?
Oh gosh.
I know it's a loaded question.
Fun
I know.
Yeah, I think thank goodness he decided to make movies. I think he's made some of the greatest movies that we have, and I think
definitely.
If you're someone who loves movies, I think he's kind of essential viewing and essential to get to know.
If you're a film buff, you got to see Stanley Kubrick's filmography. It's like some of the best films ever.
I agree, and what I like about his stuff is there's definitely jump scares in The Shining, but it's like. A space that, like,
They're scattered.
And he gives a lot of breath and time, and like just his level of exactness that he has and like the amount of takes that he this like someone who was really passionate about the craft of film and like creating kind of an entire entire worlds that are pretty unforgettable.
You don't really get filmmakers like that anymore. It's really a shame.
I think also like movies get kind of rushed a bit as well, like with The Shining there's so much great like ways that every shot is composed and like set up in specific ways, like he's famous for like the like zero-point perspective or one-point perspective, I forget which one it is, but like where it's like almost symmetrical, every frame that you can see is like how it's laid out.
Like a piece of art.
Just and that's why like it elevates The Shining as a horror movie, that you get to see like how well it's done. Nice. Whereas a lot of horror movies today are like they'll just shoot whatever they can get and don't put as much care into
that. How the heck did he do the blood in the elevator?
I was just thinking that do you guys know CGI, that?
As far as I know, I don't know if they did a miniature. I think they actually got a hallway and actually just pumped in a bunch of blood just so that they could get that shot.
That would have been such a fun day.
I'm pretty sure they just got like a giant like tanker of fake blood and just opened it up in an actual hallway set and recorded
that. So good.
Because that's one of those things where you can only do a shot like that like once to try and get it. And I'm pretty sure he would have gone the whole way with it.
I think my favorite, I think it's a tie, my favorite Kubrick films, 2001 A Space Odyssey. And A Clockwork Orange. I think
Clockwork Orange is well done.
So definitely amazing.
I love, too, that he kind of goes, like A Clockwork Orange, he goes into such, like, chilling and deep themes about, like, things that kind of still, ideas that still, like, resonate today. And I think they're pretty, all of his films are really timeless.
Like being part of a gang, just ultra-violence and sexual promiscuity and abuse. It's a crazy movie. CJ, favorite Kubrick film of all time?
Probably, split between like The Shining, Clockwork Orange, and 2001 A Space Odyssey. Like those three are just such pillars of like the film community still.
I'll tell you, with 2001, like if I'm going to sleep, I put in the Blu-ray, and that's like warm milk tea.
That's great.
It just puts me to sleep. It's just the best sleep, too. So
I love that too, because I bet if Kubrick heard that he would be so flattered. You know, like it's not a insult.
Right.
Because he's like so his films are deep.
They really are terrific, visually and you know emotionally, psychological. They're great. So guys, we have a few minutes left. I just want to go around if we have any plugs, any thing we want to talk about, any projects.
No, just my Instagram is the Cinema Gal, and just seeing right now, just seeing some great movies. I'm doing the National Novel Writing Month, which is really fun.
National Novel Writing, okay.
Yeah, it's really fun. It's just it's a month, and you write a novel, and so I've been doing that just for fun. And
so you're
just
working on a novel.
Yeah, we'll see what happens at the end of the month.
Can we get a sneak peek?
Yeah. I think it's so, like, that's what's really fun about it, is, like, right now it's kind of just, like, a bunch of words. We'll see what happens.
The whole point is, like, you just want to get words on the page, and then you, like, edit and make sense of what it is later.
Totally.
Pretty much, like, I'm doing it as well, and it's, like, as a writer, I keep going, like, I'll start writing on this story, then start writing on this story, then start writing on this one, and I'll never get back to the ones I began on. Like, you keep jumping around, so the idea of, like, National Novel Writing Month is, like, you pick one idea, and you just work on that for the whole month, and you want to try to get, like, 50,000 words done, which would be most of a novel, but it's like you want to try and work on just the one project and actually get something on it.
Now, see, I know you've been working on a bunch of stuff.
Well, yeah.
What's on the top of your mind right now? Like,
right now, I'm doing NaNoWriMo as well. I'm trying to get 50,000 words in. I'm at 4,000 words, so we're on our way there.
Nice. What's that story?
That one, it's a horror comedy kind of one I'm working on. Yeah, I think I told you a bit about it.
Yeah,
the idea is basically I want to do books that are like a setup of like a horror movie setup, except the main characters are this group of girls who are traveling around RV, just knocking into movies and helping save people. We're pretty much like, imagine if in the horror movie, the people who are most equipped just showed up to help save the day.
And they're basically movie buffs who...
Well, not like, it's not like they're doing it as movies. Like, it's just in this world, they happen to have like actual horror things happen. So people who have survived it like go around and like try and like find these things and stop them before they can kill other people.
Cool.
So it's like, imagine if you saw a movie interrupted by like Sarah Connor from T2 comes in ready to kick ass.
That's great.
I love it. Kind of like a last action hero kind of thing.
Yeah, something like that.
All right, it's cool. Ivy, are there any movies coming out soon that you want to see?
Gosh.
Now that we're almost in, we're basically coming into award season.
Yeah, so. I definitely want to see Harriet. That looks incredible.
Yep.
And there's not any that are coming to mind that that I like have to run out and see. But there's so much good.
It's been out for a few weeks now. But The Irishman, I think I need to see that. I don't know. I haven't really talked about it on the show yet, but CJ, have you seen it yet?
I haven't seen it yet. It seems interesting for like what it is, but it's like a 3-hour movie, so
don't expect like Goodfellas 2.
No, I've heard like it's more of like a full-on drama.
Yeah.
So it's like I'm not sure I'm ready to go into the city to see a 3-hour movie just yet.
right.
So it's like I'll work my way up to it.
Wait till Netflix, I guess. That's in 20 days.
That's where it's meant to be. Yeah. See him like watch it in 6 chunks where you just keep going to take a break and do something else.
Where you can pause it, that's quite a power.
Yes.
Right?
I love BoJack Horseman, so I'm so glad it's back. I'm working through that one. That's one of my favorites.
That's Will Arnett, right?
The voice. Yeah.
Okay. Will Arnett does amazing as the main character.
That's cool. Yeah. Cool. Are you a big Netflixer?
I'm a little like overwhelmed by their I think they could slow down a little bit. There's just so much that every time you go on that it's almost a little overwhelming. Like
they're always adding new stuff.
Yeah, it's pretty intense, but it's been interesting to kind of see the different projects on. Like now, Apple has a new streaming and Amazon Prime,
Disney Plus.
Disney's
they're all getting
coming
in
out with
on
the whole
it.
Thing. Everyone wants to do a streaming service.
It's crazy.
Now.
Yeah. What do you guys think of that? The streaming stuff.
I'm like Disney Plus. I had no interest in seeing it because it's like I know Disney has like a huge catalog of movies that they're hoarding, and it's like that's a good way to look into it. But I'm like I'm not really interested in buying another service. And then they come out with a trailer for The Mandalorian, and I'm like, God damn it. It looks so good. I want to see it. Oh.
It's like no point for movie theaters anymore. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah, right? that's what it's kind of fun about being in New York and seeing how they're you know, refurbishing these old theaters and making it a real experience to go out to.
Yeah. Like, I'm never going to not go to theaters. Like, I love the movie theater experience. I love seeing movies there, but it's like there's something good about being able to stream movies and see it, but you can't be like the experience of being in a theater.
No, you can't.
Seeing it with people.
True. You can't duplicate that, and you can't remove that. I mean, people used to dress up back in the day. They used to like dress up in suits and tuxedos to go to movie theaters.
Now people will wear T-shirts
and flip flops. Yeah, it's crazy.
Well, I live right down the street from the Metrograph, which is
that's
like a whole evening. The restaurant is so beautiful, and the bar, and you know, the experience of going into the theater, and the people who work there are so proud to work there. It's like really kind of become an institution too in the city, and I think that's been the great thing about it is where the movie theaters have kind of upped their game and made it a really interesting experience.
That's a great theater. I went there for the documentary Science Fair.
Oh,
so good.
Nice.
So good. Yeah, I recommend it highly. But yeah, that's the best. That's one of the best things about New York City. Everything's here. The best theaters.
Like, I love getting to go to the IFC Theater whenever they play like special kind of movies. Like every time they play The Thing, I go see that because it's so great on the big screen.
Let me know the next time you go. The midnight screenings are awesome there.
And I think it's the Village East. I could be totally wrong. Is playing The Room, and the guy's actually going to be there.
Tommy's
going to be there.
Sweet.
I mean, that's. So like you can't get that.
I think my favorite would have to be the Nighthawk Cinema in Brooklyn. Yeah.
I haven't been yet.
I
have to go.
Most of their best movies are it's weird they have brunch screenings at 11:45.
Oh, fun.
Or midnight screenings. So the movies that they usually have at the brunch screenings are usually better in my opinion. My favorite movies.
It's funny. Is the food good? I had a fun with the iPick. It's a fun thing.
Yeah,
but
it's
the
like
food
that.
Is so not. I don't.
It's
like
good.
The food, but
Nighthawk.
I
think Nighthawk's a little bit better. I mean, I've only been to iPick once, but. Yeah, the food's. It's also Alamo Draft House. That's a fun one.
Oh, nice!
I love these restaurant/theaters. Gastropub theaters are so good.
Yeah, I went to those when I was on a road trip, going through Indiana for no reason. I had nothing to do, so I'm like, let me go see a movie, and it was like a place where you could order the food and bring it to you. Except the problem was the movie I saw was A Quiet Place. Imagine a theater of people, and it's like pitch dark, and it's so perfect with suspense, all these things, and you just hear someone walking around carrying a piece to the table.
Crunch.
And he comes in and out 20 times, and everyone's eating food. And we're all sitting there like, we've made a mistake here doing this.
That is awesome. That's awesome.
That was great.
Well, guys, I think with that, we can say goodnight. Yeah. Basically, one last thing. We've got our Magnitude Jewelry, our wonderful sponsor. We got some plugs here. The Awaken Wellness Fair is happening November 24th in Tarrytown, New York. And yeah, it should be a good event. But Ivy Lawford, thank you so
much. Thank you so
Amazing.
Much. That was so much fun.
Yeah. CJ Oakland, thank you.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure, guys.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome back anytime.
Thank you.
All right.
Oh, yeah. If there's anything I've taken away from this episode, it's that we should suit up when we watch Netflix. You know, make a reality, you know?
I like
Bring
that.
Some respect and
that, yeah, that is
like
a deal.
Netflix and chill.
That is
watching.
That's what we should do.
Consider
outfits,
it done, my friend.
Yes.
Well, guys, thank you so much for watching at home or on your devices. We'll be back next week with more Under the Radar. I'm your host, Randy Younger. Thanks for watching.
Under the Radar is all new next week with more movie reviews and interviews on Strong Island Radio and Television. Stay tuned. We'll see you next week.